Welcome in the name of Jesus, the Savior of the world. We are gathered to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, to remember before God our brother, Dale Dean Anderson, to give thanks for his life, to commend him to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in our grief. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like him. And please join in with the responses. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, who formed us from the dust of the earth, who by your breath gave us life, we glorify you.
We glorify you.
Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who suffered death for all humanity, who rose from the grave to open the way to eternal life, we praise you.
We praise you.
Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence and everlasting hope, we worship you.
We worship you.
To you, O blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever.
Amen.
Yeah.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our brother Andy. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until by your call we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Corinthians chapter 15, verse 42 through 45. I'm sorry. So it will be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being, and the last Adam is a life-giving spirit.
Reading from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in the green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Fear thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all of the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Wish that I could talk to you again somehow, some way, even if it's for a moment, so I can hear you say, don't cry for me, I'm alright, I'm better than you know, and this life can be a short ride. Don't waste it on sorrow, and just hold on to those moments and the memories we shared. We're both headed for the same place anyway. I just beat you there. much I don't understand. It just don't seem fair. Don't cry for me, I'm alright. I'm better than you know. This life can't be a shorter ride, so don't waste it on sorrow. And just hold on to those moments and the memories we share. We're both made for the same place anyway. I just beat you there. As each day goes by, I get a little bit stronger. That don't stop me from wishing you were here a little bit longer. Oh, oh, when I think of you, like I know you'd want me to. And I know you're watching over me and everything I do. And all those things I never got to see, well, I said them with this prayer. Then look up, wipe my tears, and raise my beer. Oh, and I'll see you there.
I have a poem. So, God saw you getting tired, and a cure was not to be. So he put his arms around you and whispered, "Come to me." With tearful eyes, we watched you as you slowly slipped away. And though our hearts, we loved you dearly, we could not make you stay. Your golden heart stopped beating, your tired hands put to rest. God broke our hearts to prove to us he only takes the best.
I have a poem called "God Has Set Me Free." Don't hold me in your sorrow. Don't shed those tears for me. I found my heavenly tomorrow. God has set me free. I'm in a better place. I walk the streets of gold. I'm sheltered by God's grace. I have his hand to hold. You never have to worry. I have everything I need. God made me happy when my soul was free. And when your days are over, we'll surely meet again. We'll share our love and laughter when you get to heaven.
We've got a little eulogy that we put together here the other day for Dad. And let's laugh a little bit because I know he'd want to be laughing with me too. Andy was known for his huge personality and love for family and friends. Whether it was going to his favorite watering hole and asking his favorite bartender, Freddie, about his personal health issues, and always offering his medical expertise, never mind he had the health issues, or enjoying a cold beverage in his garage, Andy was in his element. Dad had many areas of expertise, including super trucker, poet, philosopher, counselor, Fox News expert, comedian, and bookie, mostly for the Vikings boards. Kept his life well-rounded. Dad enjoyed his time on the golf course, but he really struggled with teeing his ball up on hole one of the FunFest golf tournament recently. That was a doozy of a swing, but he was incredibly proud of his hole-in-one at the Emily Golf Course, and yes, there was a witness. He was always out for a good time. He especially enjoyed the stories and campfire jokes, and so did everyone else for that matter. We were so thankful that his grandkids did not repeat those rhymes in school. A favorite event every winter was the many Sunday afternoons that were spent with family and friends in the warm, balmy temps of the garage for the highs and lows of every Viking season. Andy was fortunate to get to play softball with his whole family and many friends over the years. He loved playing softball. Dad had a creative solution for any difficulty that came his way, including removing tar from places that does not belong on the human body. You can ask the family about the details later. Dad was fortunate to enjoy many years of deer hunting with great friends. Not everyone can get a monster buck like Andy and John did in 1987. My understanding is that this monster buck might have been able to have been thrown over the shoulder and carried. So Mom and the family and us, we're hoping you will share some favorite memories of Andy's today. And if it may not be appropriate at this setting, we would love to hear him at a later date. Well, if that's his, if there's any stories to share, that's great.
So he'd really like it, and the family would love it. If you would want to share a story, feel free to just stand up where you're at and share with us. And you maybe want to keep in mind that last part.
So we were building Mary and Gary's house, and Andy comes out to help us. He was going to cut plywood for us. So we kept a hole open in the master bedroom so he could hand plywood up to me. So I yelled out, "Andy, 47 3/4". So he measures over 47 3/4, and he starts to cut. Well, he can't get through all the way to reach all the way across, so he jumps up on the piece of plywood. 47 3/4, cut in half. He jumps up on the plywood, goes to finish the cut, and as he gets going, I go, "Andy, no, no." He cuts through, and boom, the whole thing falls in a pile. He's laying there. I go, "Are you okay?" He goes, "Yeah." That might have been one of the funniest things I've ever seen. Now that you're okay with it, laugh about it.
Someone else?
Might have to be some more later.
So, you're going to save them all for the family later on. All right. Thank you, Jason.
Regrettably, a lot of my stories fall in that same category. So I will, however, try to share a few of my memories. Before I do that, I would like to read the gospel message and then share some personal thoughts. And then we'll come back to the gospel message itself. I'm going to read from John chapter 1, verses 28 through 36. This all happened at Bethany, on the other side of the Jordan River, where John the Baptist was baptizing. On the next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, 'A man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to all of Israel." Then John gave this testimony: "I just saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain on is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one." The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. And when he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God. That last phrase is the one I will be coming back to in just a few minutes. Some of you may not know who I am and wonder, what am I doing up here? I first want to thank Vicar Rick and Luann and the family for inviting me and allowing me to share. My name is Mike Nelson, and one of my great claims to fame is I've known Andy forever. We grew up out in the country, south of Ballaton. We lived about a mile and a quarter apart. And I don't even remember how young we were when we started riding our bicycles back and forth between the two farm sites and playing in the grove and getting in all kinds of trouble. Sometimes we wouldn't ride the whole way. Partway between our house and their house, there was a creek that ran through some pasture land, and there was a bridge under the road, and that bridge was a cool place to sit and visit and do some other things. One of those moments, and I was not there. I heard the story from my father, who somehow or other must have drove by that day, and he saw the two bicycles and no kids. He went and looked under the bridge, and there sat Dale and my brother Bill, smoking rolled up baseball cards. We started early. We rode the bus together, being only a mile, mile and a quarter apart. There's an awful lot of stories of that bus ride, too. There wasn't a seat on the front steps, but my brother and Dale got to sit there more than once. They picked on our poor bus driver mercilessly. We baled a lot of hay together for 50 cents an hour. That was not our favorite time in life. And after 12 years of school together, we kind of went our separate ways for a little while. I went to school and taught school for a few years away from here, and then I moved back. And then we kind of kept in touch because of summers playing softball. If you read the obituary and you heard from Jason, Andy loved playing softball. Said in the obituary he played for four teams. So let me tell you, he played for any team that would ask him if he had room in his schedule. It didn't matter who or when, he was willing to play. One of the things I remember about Andy on the softball, and again in my mind it's burnt there, you could probably appreciate it as much as I do, but Andy played second base almost all the time, and he was good. He was good. He didn't make mistakes very often. But when he did, he had this unique way of kicking the dirt and spinning around, and then occasionally, if he was really disgusted, he'd throw his glove down in the dirt, and he'd be speaking to himself. And then he'd pick it up and go back to being our star second baseman. I can just see every movement in what I just described, because he did it every time the same way. It was fun. We had so much fun. Andy always had a good time playing softball and pretty much everything else, but in softball he was competitive. We played so many games. One summer we played about 120 softball games. I don't know how our families put up with it or how our bodies survived it. There was so much extra time between games at all those tournaments. I remember one year my dad was going to be the coach. He decided it wasn't for him. Andy was so, and I know most all of you know this if you knew him well, he was so funny. Yeah, he was funny. He'd have you in stitches laughing most of the time. One of my favorites was his impersonations. He could do impersonations of the unique people from our community. And he sounded more like them than they did. It was great. And the stories and the jokes, it seemed like there was an endless supply. And it was so much fun. One of my favorites in most recent years was down at the One Stop at the restaurant. He's sitting around with the early morning coffee clutch. And if something had happened to trigger Andy in the political realm, you people know it. I loved it because I pretty much shared his political views. Now, there were others at the table, not so much. But Andy would just let her go. He'd speak exactly what was on his mind, and it was so much fun because I'm just laughing inside and all those that would be of the other persuasion never said a word. I think they knew better. But then cancer came, and it was really tough on Andy. But he beat it. But then, just a few weeks ago, he was diagnosed again, the cancer came back. And it came back with a vengeance. And basically, it was as if Andy threw his glove down in the dirt, kicked the dirt with his foot, and said, game over. He said he was ready. And he wasn't ready to fight any longer. The last inning had been played in Andy's life. We're thankful for the memories of Andy, but his time on earth came to an end, as it will for all of us. But we're here today remembering a man that was well-loved by friends and family, and a man who made an imprint on so many lives, probably most of us here. At times like this, we're forced to face a reality that death is going to come to every single one of us someday, unless the Lord comes back first. How does that make us feel? Does it scare us? Are we afraid of the unknown? Are we afraid of what's coming that we're not so sure about? As Bible-believing Christians, we're encouraged that we don't have to fear. We don't have to be afraid. The Bible talks about death, where is your sting? Or death, where is your victory? In the life of a Christian, it's not the end of anything except this life here on earth. Yes, we miss the one who goes on before us, as we sung about. But it's a better place promised for all Christians. That's where it's so important to understand what Jesus did and why he came to earth. And what he came to accomplish. For Christians, we can be secure in knowing our future because we can believe what Jesus did and what only he could do. Which brings me back to the gospel and the phrase I really wanted to just point out. It was a title of Jesus that kind of is intriguing. A lot of people who aren't very familiar with the Bible might even go, what in the world does that mean? The Lamb of God. Why is he a lamb? What makes him a lamb? Why would he be referred to as the Lamb of God? The reality is, all humanity had and has a problem. We're all sinners. And I know some of you think you're pretty good, but I think if we're honest, we'd all know that we've messed up. And because of that, the scripture says in Romans 3:23 that everybody's sinned and fallen short the standard, the glory of God. And then tells us in Romans 6 that because of that there is a penalty or there is a price to be paid because of sin. And that price was death. And the wages of sin is death. And fortunately for all of us, that verse doesn't end there. It goes on and it tells us, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Sometimes we ask questions, and I think it's just right, it's fine to ask questions of God. Sometimes I've been pretty angry at God a number of times, usually when things like this happen, the things we don't understand, the things we question. But we have a God who loves us, who's a good God, who provided a way, and we refer to that way as the Lamb of God. Jesus came as a lamb. Why a lamb? Without giving us a big history lesson in the Old Testament, in the Jewish religion, there was sacrifices made continually. Thousands and thousands of sheep were slaughtered as sacrifices over hundreds of years to cover the sins of the people. They never forgave any of the sins, but they covered them temporarily. And there's that picture for us of Jesus coming as the Lamb of God. As we said, John the Baptist said, look, the Lamb of God. He is the one who takes away the sin of the world. In Hebrews 10, it tells us something that's so important to understand. And it says this in verse 12, but when this priest, in reference to Jesus, when he had offered up for all time one sacrifice for the sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Father. In verse 17 it says, "Their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more." And where these have been forgiven, sacrifice for sin is no longer needed. Because of Jesus and his sacrifice, it made a way for our sins to be forgiven. He paid a price we could never pay. He died in my place, in your place, on that cross. But he was raised from the dead. Proof to us that we one day can also be raised. And that's why he was the final sacrifice. No more sheep. She needed to die on an altar anywhere. Jesus paid the price in full. And this is why the Bible tells us in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, "Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to the mankind by which we can be saved other than Jesus." Because Jesus, the Lamb of God, by his sacrificial death, he paid a price for our sins, and he made a way that it would be possible for anyone and everyone to get to heaven if they believed in what Jesus did. He says it's the only way, but it's a way that's offered to all of us by the grace of God as a gift. All we need to do is open our hearts and receive that gift. What we do in response to that gift being offered to us is the most important thing we'll ever do. We either receive it or reject it. This is why the verse that's so familiar to so many of us, if we ever went to church or ever went to Sunday school, there's a verse that tells us our name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And that name in that book is what says, yes, you're in. How do we get there? How do we get our name in that book? What's it take? Well, on our part, very little, except receiving a gift. I want to read three verses familiar to most. John 3, verses 15 through 18, or 16 through 18. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. Whoever believes in him shall not perish, but will have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's Son, his only Son." That's why we don't have to fear death if we're a Christian. Because Jesus paid a price and made a way available to every single one of us who accept that gift of salvation through Christ. It's offered by God's grace and we receive it by faith. That's all we can do. Nothing else we do will earn our way in. Nothing else we do will get our name in that book. But receiving the gift by faith. As we all face the certainty of death one day, the important thing is, what do we do with that gift? God knows the heart of man. None of us really do. We all can ask those questions about who does this and who believes what. But the reality is, we have a kind and loving God who knows the heart of every single one of us. Amen. Thank you.
Turn to page 85 in your hymnal. And join me in the words of the Apostles' Creed. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father
Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life of the everlasting. Amen.
Your work on earth is done.
Let us pray. Your response is, hear our prayer. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give courage and faith to all who mourn, and assure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, that they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, help us in the midst of things we cannot understand to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. God of mercy, God of all grace, we give you thanks because by his death our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lived, we shall also live, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us commend Andy to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Andy. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. So at the conclusion of the worship, there will be some cupcakes and things downstairs, so we invite you to join us and to continue to share the stories that you have with Andrew. And so we'll do the prayer now. Those of you that are going outside to the military honors, you can join us there. If you want to head right down to lunch, you can do that as well. So let us pray. Dear God, we give thanks for the life of Andy as we hear the music that he enjoyed, as we hear the stories that were told. It is so obvious what a blessing he was on everyone. Be with all those who loved him. Give them the strength they'll need to carry on, but help them to always remember to not forget all the joy that he brought. And as we go down to share fellowship time, continue to remember the joy that he brought, the joy that will help all of his family members, all of his friends, to get through the days that will be at times a struggle. Grant peace, grant strength to all those who will miss him. We pray all this in your name. Amen. And now, go forth in peace. In the name of Christ, amen.
Please rise.
Hope is a thing with heaven. Purchase on the soul. Get the oldest young thing standing there, strong against the cold. I reached into my pocket, said a penny for your poetry. When I handed him the dollar bill, he was shaking his head at me. Then he said these words to me: in my Father's house are many mansions. Though tonight some make their beds along the street, where I see life still by winter's bitter chill. In house, there's a mansion for me. Sleep is a silent pleasure behind doors with deadbolt locks, but it's a concrete nightmare chance you take on the streets in a cardboard box. But I know about the eye of the needle and what will come to pass when the least of us shall be first, and the first now shall be last. Who's homeless now, I ask? In my Father's house, many mansions, though tonight some make their beds along the street, where I've seen life still by winter's bitter chill. In my Father's house, there's a mansion for me. In my Father's house, many mansions, though tonight some make their beds along the street, where I've seen life still by winter's bitter chill. In my Father's house, there's a mansion for me.
Up and down my spine, 'cause I know that my love. the salute.
Here's your property back. Do you know what cemetery it's at?
Thank you.
Yeah. I'm just trying to figure out how to turn it off. And this one?
That's ours.
This one's ours.